Yeah, we can go ahead. Okay, so you had some question.
Yes,
what is the question? Can you tell me?
Yeah, I told that, you know, that at the end of the day, every jiva is destined to first self-realization. And I mentioned the analogy of going from Hyderabad to Bangalore.
Yeah.
The destinations are fixed, but however, the path can change.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, then you said that, you know, it's like a dream wherein, you know, it's a travel in time and space, mm-hmm. but at the end of the day, it's one jump.
Correct.
But actually, there is no journey at all. It's a pathless path.
Yeah, in the sense, the final spiritual path is a jump.
Huh?
But if you consider every search for happiness as a spiritual journey, then it's a many, many things you'll explore.
Right.
Okay.
Right. Sir, one more question I had was this: is this thing like, you know, you said that the jiva gets frustrated because he's seeking for happiness in objects,
mm-hmm.
and he's not able to find it. And he meets, you know, he slowly goes to a temple and he meets, like, you know, a pranayama. Then
yeah.
he goes to like a guru, and like the guru shows us the way. So, you know, now is it that seeking that should come to a such a state that, you know, you are so frustrated about everything, and you know, you have to turn yourself within, and so that the criteria of frustration is it inevitable?
What is criteria for what is the question?
The question is that, you know, is the frustration inevitable? Is it necessary and sufficient condition to seek within? It's like still many of us actually search for happiness outside, right? And yet we don't feel like, you know, happiness is inside. So even though, you know, many of the students come to Vedanta and understand the thing, so now do we need to go to that necessary suffering so that we are able to turn
this? It is a journey of many, many lifetimes.
Okay.
Okay, it is not one lifetime.
Okay.
Okay, so, I mean, as per teaching of Vedanta and Sanatana Dharma, you go through a large number of lifetimes. That's why Sri Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Bahunam Janmanamante Jnanaman Mam Prapadyate. Okay, many, many lifetimes will go.
Mm-hmm.
In many, many lifetimes, you explore a lot of things, different things.
Mm-hmm.
And what is the purpose of exploring different things? To get happiness and permanent happiness.
Absolutely.
Okay, and there will be hope after hope that I'll get permanent happiness. Hope after hope, you keep on trying, exploring many things.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
So whether it will converge, the hope will converge and you come to a conclusion, yes, eventually, but it may take a large number of lifetimes, maybe a million lifetimes, I don't know.
Billion?
Not million, I'm saying. It may be million lifetimes also.
Okay.
So whether the search will converge to something, we don't know. It will converge, but eventually, but it's a long, long journey. That's what is called Punarapi Jananam, Punarapi Maranam. It will go on forever. Okay, see, you understand the life. Okay, here in the life is you are in a world where sense objects are dominating.
Hmm.
Your cultural conditioning, your society, your family conditioning is dominating.
Absolutely.
You have no clue that the self is bliss.
Absolutely.
Okay, so it's like a blindfolded situation.
Absolutely.
Okay. You keep on searching here, there, this way, that way. You go through many yoga paths, bhakti yoga, jnana yoga, bhakti yoga, kriya yoga, many other paths also.
Right.
Okay, so basically you are actually searching. And what happens is that in some of the paths, okay, so-called paths,
uh-huh.
okay, it may be bhakti yoga or it may be karma yoga, you may feel comfortable. Okay, there's a feeling of comfort also is there. You'll get into comfort zone.
Right.
Okay. So, I am in this path and this give me at least happiness which is better than something else.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So you don't reach the destination, but you on the path itself you feel, I mean, it's called so-called path, you feel comfortable. The comfort with, can be with the path, the comfort with, can be with the guru, comfort can be with the deity. Okay? So there itself you'll spend a lot of time. When I say a lot of time, it may be a lot of lifetimes. Okay? So then, even that, see, the danger in the spiritual path is a comfort zone. Okay? Somebody may be having a very joyful experience, blissful experience. Seeing some light and seeing some spiritual, what you call as miracles, powers, or whatever is that. So people get stuck at various places. Okay? And this journey doesn't terminate that easily. Okay? When I say that easily, it's not, journey is not difficult. Jump is not difficult. But people don't, people get into some comfort zones. So the way that analogy example is given is for that. A person, poor fellow, is searching for wealth. Okay, then he goes to a forest and one monk is sitting. He asks, monk says, okay, just go a few kilometers, you will find a copper. He goes there and very happy with the copper, he comes back. And he enjoys for a couple of years. Then he, after exhausting, he again goes back. Then this time he, after a couple of miles away, he finds what you call silver. So like that story goes on, goes on, goes on. He, many years are gone. He is finding diamond and all those things. So it's a long time, right? What happens is, in this journey, in the time and space, you will get stagnate or feel comfort in many, many levels. Okay? So to the real, what is ultimate real, what you go there is very few. Okay? Because very few, not because that is difficult, but you get into various domains of comfort. Okay, this guy finally, once he finds the diamond and down, that also he exhausts, then he is surprised. This monkey is telling so many things. Okay, so why he is not going and picking up? Then he goes and asks the monk and then says, monk, I am peaceful and happy. So like that, what happens? We keep on going in journey. We can say, in a sense, you can call spiritual journey where we are looking for happiness, or you can say spiritual journey in the material domain. So it goes on and goes on. There's a lot of stagnation happens, a lot of comfort level happens. Okay, and even if you get a realized master, because of your inherent vasanas tendencies, you may not get to the point. So like that, it goes. Okay. So this is the challenge of a spiritual journey. Okay?
And, yeah.
Eventually he may reach there, but that eventuality is, it may be a couple of millions or a couple of billion years.
Okay.
Subject
to condition.
Huh?
Subject to condition.
No, subject to condition is a person, it's ultimately a, the inner urge for a person, right? So the urge for a person, it may take, it may happen in one lifetime or many lifetimes. So the question is, but by that time, he has matured, okay? He has seen everything, be there, okay? And he has come to a conclusion, this doesn't work. At least in this journey, he has come to a conclusion, what all doesn't work?
Yeah, right.
Okay, the what all doesn't work is a big list.
Right.
Okay? So, but until you explore the what all doesn't work, how will somebody get into something what works?
Right.
So that is actually what you call a self effort. He has to come to a point of self exhaustion. Okay. So is that necessary? Definitely it is necessary, because without that, his urge for looking inwards and realizing self will be, the urge will be very less. Okay. Because he has a hope after hope that there is something else will work which is more comfortable. That you can see many people who are in the spiritual path, they get stuck to something and they think that is the beauty, that is the best thing which can happen. So my deity is superior, my path is superior, I'm happy here. So many things will happen. So eventually somebody reaches there is very few. That person, that soul who has reached there, has gone through a lot of ripening in life, in one lifetime or many lifetimes. That's why he.
Krishna,
that's why Sri Krishna says bahunam janmanamante, many lifetimes will go.
So you're we need not worry about, you know, this, because I ask this question because, you know, sometimes I feel as if, you know, it's a goal and you have to attain it, and you know, there is a lot of strife and strain that will go through it. So now this gives me a comfort that, you know, okay, no, you have to have sufficient ripening, and it's a natural process that happens over a period of time.
In a sense, yes. Okay, it is in a sense, it is a ripening happening over a long period of time. But it's also true that once you start these questions, what you are asking now, they're appropriate questions, they'll also come after some amount of ripening has already gone through. It's not that your questions are not a question of a novice. Okay, so definitely these questions are coming from sincere seeking.
Right.
Okay, so from that perspective, yes, probably not in this lifetime, many other lifetimes you have gone through some of the understandings. Your question is, what is happiness and how do somebody become happy?
Yeah.
See, happiness means a expanded state of consciousness.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
When you are happy, you feel as if you don't have boundary. You lose a sense of boundary. Okay. You become a boundaryless being. So that boundaryless condition is called happiness. Okay. Otherwise, you feel restricted. You feel constricted. Either by circumstance or body-mind complex or by the situation or the pain and suffering, you feel constrained. You feel contracted. You feel limited. Happiness is a glimpse of expansion. Okay, now how does happiness, you have to understand the mechanism of happiness. Okay, so ultimately it is only consciousness which is there. The consciousness in its original state, it's infinite and boundaryless. It's a dimensionless also, in the sense it's not in time and space. Whereas when the consciousness takes the body form, it is constrained, it's constricted, it's limited. Okay, so this limited consciousness has forgotten its true nature. Deep inside, it is craving for that. Okay, at the same time, it's trying to find out that happiness in the objects of the world. So now, the moment you start finding the object of the world, an object is a thought. A thought is the consciousness has taken further constraint. Okay. Body itself is a limitation for the consciousness. A thought is a further limitation. It becomes a narrow. Consciousness becomes very constrained.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So now, what will happen? When I say consciousness or mind, I'm using the term synonymously.
Right.
So mind is thought. Thought is nothing but consciousness. Consciousness which has taken further limitation. Okay, so now what will happen? I'm just giving an example. Let's say you want a jalebi.
Right.
Okay, why? Because I want to feel, I feel like eating jalebi and I feel happy about it.
Right.
So your mind starts constantly craving for jalebi.
Right.
and it generates more and more thoughts about jalebi.
Right.
And when it generates thoughts about jalebi, okay, ultimately thoughts are appearing in your nervous system, body and all.
Absolutely.
And it'll heat the engine. In the sense, the nervous system gets, strained.
Right.
Okay? This strain you feel in the body-mind complex.
Right.
Okay, I want something. There's a feeling of craving, and this puts a pressure on the
right.
System.
Yeah.
Okay, you may not say, the word may not be exact pressure, but ultimately it results in some chemical reaction in the body and mind.
Right.
This we call as stress. Okay, stress is total opposite of bliss.
Okay.
Right. So, what is that? Let us take the example of jalebi. I want jalebi. Thought comes often.
Mm-hmm.
Then one day you get a jalebi.
Mm-hmm.
You put the jalebi in your mouth.
Mm-hmm.
So, then what happens? Suddenly this thought stops because you have achieved your goal.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Right.
The moment thought stops, what will happen to the wave? The thought is a wave in consciousness. So the wave goes back to the ocean.
Right.
Momentarily.
Right.
Okay. So now wave has become one with the ocean. So wave is nothing but a restricted form of ocean.
Right.
So now it has merged with the ocean for a moment.
Right.
So now it finds it is expanded.
Mm.
And that expanding of expansion is called happiness.
Right.
So now you have to understand that the jalebi was put into the mouth.
Right.
And because you put jalebi into the mouth, the thoughts stopped.
Right.
And that led to happiness.
Right.
Okay? That led to state of expansion and happiness.
Right.
Okay? Now, what gave happiness really?
The
expansion of consciousness in its own nature.
Right.
Okay, so you have found your nature momentarily, unconsciously, not consciously.
Right.
But after the jalebi experience is over, again mind comes up. So now it remembers, last thing it remembers is I ate jalebi and I became happy. So it associates happiness with jalebi, not with consciousness.
Right.
It's a wrong misconception that happiness came from jalebi.
Right.
Happiness didn't come from jalebi. Happiness was a trigger which stopped the mind.
Right.
Stopping of the mind went back to consciousness, and there the happiness was there.
Right.
The source of happiness is not jalebi. Source of happiness is consciousness. This relationship mind is not able to understand.
Right.
So now what happens? Again the mind comes back and says, I am happy. So the moment you say I am happy, your happiness is over because thought has come now.
Right, exactly.
Okay? By the time you say happiness, I am happy, the thought has, happiness has disappeared.
Right.
It's only post facto.
Right.
When you are happy, there's no thought of happiness.
Right.
Okay? The moment thought of happiness came, the happiness is gone. And next moment comes, I am happy because I ate jalebi. So now you start looking for more jalebi. Without understanding the relationship between jalebi and happiness.
Right.
Jalebi was just a trigger for silencing the mind.
Right.
Okay. So if you know how to silence the mind without jalebi, then you will not look for any experience in the world.
Absolutely.
And that's what is called enlightenment.
Now, this is an understanding that I get. Now, but when I look at my mind, there are lots of thoughts,
then
there are lots of
anxiety. Your question is, how do
I
silence the mind? Okay.
Right.
See, the mind silence and silencing the mind requires what you call as self-discovery and self-awareness.
Right.
So, one of the paths which Ramana Maharshi told, inquire into nature of who am I? Okay? So, basically, inquiring into your nature of the mind, you can find mind becomes silent. So for many people, just this why am I inquiry requires a lot more support in terms of understanding this inquiry process. It's not just a simple of question of who I'm asking, who am I? It requires understanding of the nature of the mind, nature of experience, nature of consciousness. So some more clarity is required. Okay. So the mind has to fall back into itself. So mind is built upon layers and layers of assumptions. So if you go through a self-inquiry process under the guidance of a qualified master, he will start asking the questions which will expose a lot of underlying assumptions in the mind. Okay, these, then what happens is the moment you the assumptions become to the, come to the consciousness, conscious mind, those assumptions will disappear. And as long as these assumptions collapse one after the other, the mind collapses into the consciousness. Okay? It is not a forced way of silencing the mind. It's a process of inquiry by which the, if you think the mind is like a stool, okay? A stool where you can sit, right? So the stool has four legs. These four legs are assumptions. Various assumptions. So, for example, one assumption is I am the body. You have taken for granted.
Right, right.
So, one assumption is I am happy with the getting a jalebi.
Right, right.
So, these are the assumptions, not reality.
Right, right, right.
A realized master will take up the assumption by assumption. He pull out the rug under the assumptions. So, then what will happen? These assumptions held in your consciousness unconsciously. If they are unconscious assumptions. So once these assumptions become conscious, then no longer that assumption can hold you. So then what will happen? If you pull out the four legs of the stool will collapse. Similarly, mind will collapse into the self. So this is what you call as process of self-inquiry. Okay? It's not just a blind way of asking, who am I, who am I, who am I? No. So probably a Vedanta teacher will teach this process of self-inquiry more in terms of technical details, very clear technical details. Okay. Finally, it is actually understanding deep-rooted assumptions in the mind. And as you start inquiring to the assumptions in the mind, those assumptions will stop dropping. As the assumption drops, the mind becomes more and more silent. Okay.
Is it good to go through that
structured way?
See,
the structured way has certain advantage. Okay.
So
structured way, it's like Upanishad, Vedanta, all those things. It's a long study. Okay. It is like a more like a classical dancing or classical music. So it has the classical beauty, and music has its beauty, classical dance it has beauty, it has beauty.
Okay.
So if you require a very systematic study of Vedanta, I'll say no. Okay. So, ultimately Vedanta is uncovering a lot of assumptions which you have. Okay. For some people, they have to go through that amount of study and confidence before they can realize the self. Progressively, they get more and more confidence in teaching of Vedanta and they get it. Okay. For mature souls, like some other, Ramana Maharshi says, self-inquiry is suitable for mature souls. So, some souls are so mature, a bit of self-inquiry under the guidance of a competent teacher who is qualified in self-inquiry, they can straight away get it. This is what you call as direct path. Okay? So if your question is whether you have to study Vedanta and go through it, and or you can go through the direct path. The answer is yes and no, because I don't know the answer. I don't know. It goes on the based on the specific individuals in this background.
Okay.
Right? But if you ask a question, is there a way of getting self-realization without going through very detailed study of scriptures? Yes, through self-inquiry.
Mm. Right.
So that is called path of direct path.
Direct path, right.
Okay.
Right.
Okay,
yeah.
I'll put it this way. So Vedanta gives a very good framework for self-realization.
Right.
Okay, but it's a long way and many detailed, many steps, many, it has a its own journey type. Okay, but the self-realization itself is understanding nature of the self by a sharp intellect which is capable of inquiry under the guidance of a master who can ask right questions.
Right.
So then what will happen? The formal study becomes not so important.
Right.
But I'll say still a formal background of Vedanta can give confidence. On the other hand, a realized master is living book of Vedanta. Okay? So presence of a living master who is living Vedanta, then your study is cut short. Because a living example sits in front of you. So then if you ask, do I have to go through all the study? The answer is no.
Right? Sir, you, two more questions, sir.
Hmm?
So one is with respect to, you know, it says that, you know,
No, first, did you did I answer your earlier question?
Yes, yes, sir. Yeah, very clearly, sir. Very clear.
Okay, fine.
Yeah. So one more thing is that, you know, it is said that, you know, we have discussed that you know, the universal consciousness has identified itself with this body and mind,
right.
And you know, it is seeking for happiness in the outside world of it.
Right.
So, right, if there is one, it is one universal consciousness, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that is actually identified with this body and mind.
Mm-hmm.
So now, if the universal consciousness is one, why does it, like, you know, if Ramana Maharshi is realized, why I'm not realized? Because it's one, right?
Okay. So the answer for that, the universal consciousness doesn't identify with your body and mind directly. Okay.
Mm.
The Vedanta says universal consciousness manifests in body and mind of multiple individuals through a process known called Chidabhasa. Chidabhasa means reflected consciousness. Reflected consciousness is similar to original consciousness. Okay. Any knowledge or ignorance is happening in the reflected consciousness, nothing is happening to original. So original consciousness or universal consciousness is one. Reflected consciousness are many. Okay, sun is one. Reflection of sun is many. So if one reflection becomes free, still other reflections will continue to be there.
Right.
Okay, original is same. Original, nothing is affected. Okay. So this is the reason, even if Ramana Maharshi is realized, you are not realized. Because you are another reflection in another body-mind complex. Reflections are many, but original is one. Reflections of a sun in a lake is same as sun. But reflections can be many reflections. Okay? So, what is happening in the bondage and